Good morning. So we'll start. How long to wait? So someone is asking me to do revision. So I'm doing the revision for the people who asked me. Okay. So I told you for your internals, you have second half and third. So second half you can go through. I'm just doing revision only for the third one. So in the third module, what we have interface. So what do we mean by interface? Interface. People keep joining, I have to admit them. That becomes a problem. That's why I was waiting for 5 minutes. So the interface is a reference type in Java. So it is similar like to class, but what is difference between class and interface? It is a collection of abstract methods. So in the interface, we don't implement. So instead of that, the methods variable will be abstract. A class implements an interface, thereby inheriting the abstract method of the interface along with along with the abstract method, an interface may also contain constants, default method, static method, and nested types. So method bodies exist only for the default methods and static methods. Writing an interface is similar to writing a class, but a class describes the attributes and behavior of an object. And an interface contains behavior that a class implements. Unless the class that implements the interface is abstract, all the methods of the interface need to be defined in the class. So then what is an interface? An interface is similar to the class in the following ways. An interface can contain any number of methods. An interface is written in a file with a .java extension with the name of the interface matching the name of the file. The bytecode of an interface appears in a .class file. The interface appear in the package and their corresponding bytecode file must be in a directory structure that matches the package. So then how do we declare an interface? The interface keyword is used to declare an interface. Here is a simple example to declare an interface. So we generally, what we do, we take import dot java dot language, so a header file for all the programs in Java. So then public interface, name of the interface. So public, why? The interface can be used by the class, and interface keyword is compulsory, and name of the interface, you can give any name of the interface, and open with the brackets. And within that brackets, you can give any number of final static fields. So if you want to declare any variables, you can declare them. But how the declaration of the methods, it will be final and a static. The any number of abstract method declaration. So you can have any number of methods which are declared. Then creating an interface name, declare constant field, declare methods that abstract by the default. So this is the syntax for creating an interface. So declare an interface, use a interface keyword. It is used to provide a total abstraction. That means, see, people come, keep coming, and we have to allow them, and we get disturbed. Okay, to declare an interface, we use interface keyword. It is used to provide a total abstraction. That means all the methods in the interface are declared with empty body and are public, and all fields are public, static and final by default. A class that implements interface must implement all the methods declared in the interface. To implement interface, use a implements keyword. Why do we use interface? It is used to achieve a total abstraction. Since Java does not support multiple inheritance in case of class, but by using interface, it can achieve multiple inheritance. So it is also used to achieve loose coupling. Interface are used to implement abstraction. So the question arises, why use interface when we have abstract class? So the difference between a class and an interface, class, in the class, you can instantiate variables and create an object. In the interface, you cannot instantiate variables and create any object. So in case of class, class can contain concrete methods. So that's what with implementation. So in the interface cannot contain concrete methods. We cannot, the implementation will not be concrete. Then access specifier used with a class can be private, public, and protected. Whereas with respect to interface, only one specifier is used as public. So then how do we implement an interface? This is how a class implements an interface. It has to provide the body of all the methods that are declared in the interface, or in other words, you can say that class has to implement all the methods of the interface. So here in this program, the interface name interface is my interface. And what are the methods we have? We have two methods, method one and method two. And we are using that interface in a class called as a demo. And what we are doing in method one, just printing, that is system.out.println, implementation of method one. So public void method two, implementation of method two. Then public static void main string arguments, my interface object equals to new demo. So an object dot method one. So that's how here the interface is. So the interface, what we are doing, interface, my interface, we have method one and method two. So in a method one, a system.out.println, that is method of implementation of method one and implementation of method two. Then my interface, we are creating an object for interface and for a class object. So you're just calling object.method one. So what is there in object.method1? Method 1 is only having implementation of method 1. Only that will be displayed. Using interface reference, we can declare variables as object reference that use an interface rather than a class type. Any instance of any class that implements the declared interface can be referred to by such a variable. When you can call a method through one of these interface, the correct version will be called based on the actual instance of the interface being referred to. This is one of the key features of interface. The method to be executed is looked up dynamically at runtime, allowing classes to be created later than the code which calls methods on them. The following program calls the top speed method via an interface reference variable. Notice that the variable speed is declared to be a interface by speed, yet it was assigned an interface of OD, instance of OD. Although speed can be used to access the top speed method, it cannot access any other members of OD class. An interface reference variable has knowledge along only on the method declared by its interface declaration. So we can see here the interface speed, avoid top speed, class OD, then implements the speed. So we are using the speed from a interface and the top speed in the Audi implements. Sushma. People are still joining. Okay, in the class Audi implements the interface speed, and what is the implementation of top speed? So it is Audi taking 250 kilometers per hour. So in the same way, class Prod implements speed, and that is Prod 220 kilometers per hour. So then BMW speed will be 300. So again, these are the three classes and one interface speed. And creating an object for the speed and the Audi, so that is speed dot top speed, what the thing. So the same way, creating one more object for the Prod and the BMW, and display what is there, the respective speeds. So we know that Audi is taking 250 kilometers per hour, and Prod is taking 220, and BMW is taking 300 kilometers per hour. But then implementing multiple interface, a Java class can only extend one parent class. Multiple inheritance, that is extends, is not allowed. Interface are not classes, however, and a class can implement more than one interface. The parent interface are declared in a comma separated list after the implementing keywords. Here is an example that shows how to implement multiple interface in the Java. So you can see here we have used two interface, that is I1 and I2. In I1, what we have taken one string, one method of type string and abstract. So in the same way, in I2 also abstract and the string and method two and class. So this program gives us a look of how the multiple interfaces can be used in the class. So class multiple interface. So it implements I1 and I2. So public string method, in string method 1 returns hello from method 1, and method 2 hello from method 2. So then public static void main string. So then multiple interface MI equals to new multiple interface. So hello. So what is there in the method 1? So in the method 1, hello from method 2 and hello from method 2. These two will be displayed. Because MI is a object created for the class. So then overloaded constructor, the Java example has a class with two constructors. So that is class overloaded constructor, public static void main string. And here we have a class name as dog. And for that we have taken two constructors, a dog with one parameter, and that parameter is of type string. So then this dot name equals to name. So one more constructor where we are not passing any parameters. So this no name. So that's what your dog and a dog is doing. Dog D1 equals to new dog. So dog D2 equals to new dog. So here we have passed one parameter spot, and in other constructor we have not passed any variable. So then again system.out.println, so display d1.name. So what is there in d1.name? So in d1.name, d1 is object created for a constructor with parameter. So d2 is object created for constructor dog without parameter. So that's what here you can see d1name equals to spot, d2name there will be no name there. In the same way, constants in the interface in Java, a programming language, the constant interface pattern describes the use of an interface. So only to define constants and having classes implements that interface in order to achieve convenient syntactic access to those constants. However, since constants are very often merely an implementation details, and the interface implemented by a class are part of its exported API. So here in this interface, we have used a constant. And what is a constant? So public static final int constant. What is the value for the constant keyword? We have assigned it as a 1. So the same way class 1 implements constant, then public static final int constant equals to 2, then public static void main string arguments throws exception. So then system dot out dot println calling a constant. Which constant we are calling? Which is there in the class? In the class we have a 2 for the constant, so that 2 will be displayed instead of interface. Instead of interface 1. So then interface can be extended. Yes. When one interface inherits from another interface, the sub interface inherits all the methods and the constants that its super interface declared. In addition, it can also declare a new abstract method and constants. To extend an interface, you can use the extends keyword just as you do in a class definition. Unlike a subclass, which can directly extend only one subclass, an interface can directly extend multiple interfaces. Now let us consider a program that demonstrates how interface extends another interface. So interface, so we have given interface 1. So in that public void function is F1. So then one more interface that is used to see how the extends is working with respect to interface. So interface 2 extends interface 1. Means what? So whatever the properties present in the interface 1 is can be accessed in the interface 2. And what is there in the interface 2? So we have a public void F2. So then class X implements interface 2, public void F1, system.out.println, contents of method M1 is interface 1. So the public void F2, contents of method F2 is interface. So then F3, content of method F3 of class X. So then class extending interface, public static void main string arguments. So then interface V2, V2 dot new X. So V2 dot F1, V2 dot F2. So we are calling the interfaces F1 and F2. Then creating one more object X1. So call again a third method F3. So that's how here the output of this will be content of method F1 in interface 1, content of method F2 in interface 2, then content of method F3 of class X. So then what is nested interface? So same way how we have class within one more class, if within one more if, same way we have something called as a nested interface. So we can declare the interface as member of a class or another class, another interface. Such an interface is called as member interface or nested interface. So here we can see class test, and in that method we have taken protected interface. So then within that one more method called as a show method, and we are extending that class. So that is using the implements. So testing implements test.s. So within that one more method, show method. So show a method of interface. Then class A, public static void main string. So test.s object, testing t equals to new testing, object equals to t, object.show. So that's how here we have a nested interface. So next we move on package. So package and member access and importing packages. A Java package is a group of similar types of class, interface and a sub package. The package in Java can be categorized in two forms, built-in package and user-defined package. There are many built-in packages such as Java language, AWT, JavaX, Wing, Net, input output, utility, SQL. So like this, these are the different packages available in a Java. So then what is package fundamentals? A package is a collection of related class. It implements organize your classes into a folder structure and make it easy to locate and use them. So more importantly, it helps improve reusability. Each package in Java has its unique name and organizes its class and interface into a separate namespace or name group. So here we can see there is a package called as a shape. So in that package shape, so we have a class circle. So in that circle, we are just creating one more method, C area, calculating the area of a circle. So then what is the formula for area of a circle? That is pi r square. So that is stored in a CA. And how, what is the declaration we have taken for CA? It is taken as a double. So then display them using a system.out.println, that is area of a circle, and display CA. So then one more package. So that shape, again, within that package, we have one more class called as a square. So we are calculating the area of a square with the method S area. So then what is formula for a square? 4a means 4 times the square, sides of the square. So all the sides are equal, then B it is a square. Then display the area of a square. Then we are taking one more called as a triangle. So then a T area. So then what are the values we are passing? We are passing breadth into height. So then how do we calculate a triangle? Triangle is half into base into height. This is a formula which we have already known. So that is TA equals to 0.5 into base into height, and display the area of a triangle. So now we start with the main class method. So then class area, then public static void main, so then string. So then here we are creating the separate objects for each class. First we are creating for a triangle. So that is TO object, triangle object equals to new triangle. So then display, pass the values for a method called as a T area. So that is T area 3, 5 with an object called as a TOB. Similar fashion with a circle. Circle we are creating a object called as a COB, and pass using a method and using a reference, that is COB, we are passing a value 5. So in the same way, square SOB, we are creating an object for a square SOB, and using a method called as area, we are passing 10 and SOB, and displaying the area of a triangle, area of a circle, and area of a square. So that's about a thing. So then built-in packages. So what are the built-in packages we have? So these packages consist of large number of classes which are present, which are part of a Java API. So some of the commonly used built-in packages are java.language. So what is present in this package contains language support classes. Example classes, class which define primitive data types, math operations. This package is automatically imported. java.io, so contains class for supporting input and output operations. java.utility contains utility class which implement data structures like linked list, dictionary, and support, as well as for date and time operations. So again, some more built-in packages, that is java.applet contains classes for creating applets. So then AWT, abstract window toolkit, contains classes for implementing the components for graphical user interface like button, menus, etc. If you want to create any forms or any menus or buttons, then we can use a AWT. So then we have one more package called as a java.net, contains classes for supporting networking operations. So you want some networking operation, then we can use a java.net. So then user defined package, yes. So built-in package is already present with respect to compiler. There may be some situations where user defined packages means we want to create a package for my own project. So in that case, yes, it is available for us to create a user defined package. So there are packages that are defined by the user. First we create a directory, my package. Name should be same as the name of the package. Then create the my class inside the directory with the first statement being the package names. Static import, Java, a static import. The static import features of Java 5 facilitates the Java programmer to access any static member of a class directory. There is no need to quantify it by the class name. So advantage of static import, less coding is required if you have access any static members of a class oftenly. Disadvantage of static method, if you overuse the static import features, it makes the program unreadable and unmaintainable. These are the advantages and disadvantages of static. So now take one small example, small program. So import static.java.language.system. So class, static import example. So then public static void main string and arguments. So then system out.println. So instead of writing system.out, we can directly write, because in the header file we have given java.language.system. So if you have just given java.language, then you here we have to include it as a system.out.println. Because in the header file we have already included system, so here we can start with out.println. So then out.println java. So that's what about the using a header files and the importing them. So next we move on to exception handling. So what is exception handling? We may feel that in the programming, maybe somewhere some mistakes may occur. So in that case, what we do is we use exceptions. So what these exceptions will do in case if we feel that within these three lines, there are chances of errors to occur. So in that case, we can use a exception handling. So then exception is an abnormal condition that arises in a code sequence at runtime. In other words, an exception is a runtime error in computer language that do not support exceptional handling. Errors must be checked and handled manually, typically through the use of error codes. This approach is as cumbersome as avoiding the, it is a troublesome. So Java exception handling avoids these problems and in the process brings runtime error management into the object-oriented world. So the Java exception is an object that describes an exception condition that has occurred in a piece of code. When an exceptional condition arises, an object representing that exception is created and throws in a method that caused the error. The methods may choose to handle the exception itself or pass it on. So either way, at some point the exception is caught and processed. Exception can be generated by a Java runtime system or they can be manually generated by the source code. Exceptions thrown by Java related to the fundamentals error that violate the rules of the Java language or the constraints of the Java execution environment. Manually generated exceptions are typically used to represent, to report some errors, conditions to be called of the method. So Java exception handling is managed using five keywords. So first one is try catch, try block, catch, throw, throws, and throws. So that's how here we use them. First one, try. I suspected code segment is kept inside try block. Catch, the remedy is written within a catch block. Throw, whenever a runtime error occurs, the code must throw an exception. So throws, if a method cannot handle any exception by its own, and since some abstraction method needs to handle them, then a method can be specified with a throws keyword, which with its declaration. Finally, the block should contain the code to be executed after finishing a try catch block. So this is a small syntax how we can use a try catch. So start from a try, and open or close the curl brackets, and you within that you can write any code which you feel that there may be some error. You may feel there may be some rounding error or some way somewhere he forgot something like that. We can write in the block of code. That's what here try catch. So then exception handler for exception type one, then catch. So what you feel that whether there is an error in the exception two or just a food. So exception handler for exception type. So finally, once we have done with finally and exceptional catches, so we have, in case if there are some projects where it should be still refined, then we can use a finally. So what is this finally? We'll be doing a block of code to be executed after try block statement. So then exception type, all the exceptions are the derived classes of built-in class via throwable. It has two subclasses, that is exception and error. That's what here the diagrammatic representation of throwable, so exception and error. So in the exception, runtime exception automatically defined with program. So then customer exception, user defined class to handle own exception. So then error, customized exception, user defined class to handle own exceptions. So exception class is used for exceptional conditions that user programs should catch. If we can inherit some of this classes to create our own custom exception types, there is an important subclass of exception called runtime exception. So exceptions of this type are automatically defined for the programs that you can see how we can write and include them, such as divide by zero, invalid array indexing. So like this, in these situations we can use a exception. So then what is error? Error class defines exception that are error. How you will get error, man? So error class defines exception that are not accepted to be caught under normal circumstances by our program. Exception of type error are used by the Java runtime system to indicate error having to do with the runtime environment itself. Stack Overflow is an example of such error. So here uncaught exception. Let us see what happens if we do not handle the exception. So class, so here we have a method, public static void method, main method. And here we don't have, we are not used a try and catch, or we have not concentrated for a exception. So in this case, we know that D is zero and A equals to 42 divided by zero will be infinite. So how long this should we keep running? So then we have to use a exception. When the Java runtime system detects the attempts to divide by zero, it constructs a new exception object and then throws this exception. This causes the exception of exception zero to stop, because once an exception has been thrown, it must be caught by any exception handler and dealt with immediately. Since in the above program we have not supplied any exception handler of our program, so the exception is caught by a defaulter, however provided by a Java runtime system. Any uncaught exception is handled by the default handler. The default handler displays a string describing the exception, prints a stack trace from the point at which the exception occurred, and terminates the program. Here is an exception generated when above examples is executed. So then java.language.arithmeticexception slash div by zero, then at exception zero main. So the stack trace display class name, method name, file name, and a line number causing the exception. Also, the type of exception thrown is a arithmetic exception, which is the subclass of exception is displayed. The type of exception gives more information about what type of error has occurred. So the stack traces will always shown the sequence of methods innovations that leads up to the error. So taking an example, class exp public static void main void subroutine, then int d equals to 0, d equals to 10 by d. So because d is 0, and if you replace that, so this method will be infinite. So to avoid such type of things, we are using a try and catch block. So the resulting stack tree from the default exception handler shows how the entire stack, call stack, is displayed. A default exception handler shows the entire call stack is displayed, java.language.arithmetic exception. So if I say arithmetic exception, what is this type of exception? Java.language.arithmetic exception divide by zero at execution 1.subroutine exception 1.java.z6. So if you are using try and catch, handling the exception by your own is very much essential, as we can display appropriate error message instead of allowing java.runtime to display a stack trace. So it prevents the program from automatic termination. So here in this case, we can see to handle runtime error, we need to enclose the suspected code within a try block. So that's what here exception, and we have called the class as ex2. Then public static void main. So again, declare a variable d comma a. So we are using the try and catch. So in this, d initialized to 0, a equals to 42 by d. So here, because d is 0, so this will move on to the infinite loop. So to, and we have to display that this is moving on for infinite loop, because anything divided by 0, so will become infinite. So this will not be printed. So catch arithmetic exception e. So then system out dot println division by 0. System out dot println after each statement. So the goal of most well constructed catch clauses should be resolved the exception conditions, and then continue on as the error hand never happened. So in this case, you can see how the Java import java.delete.random. So then class handler error. So public static void main int a equals to 0, b equals to 0, and random r, creating an object for a random. So r equals to new random. So then start from the for loop for it. For I equals to 0, I is less than 10. So then try b equals to r dot next I, next integer. So in the same way, c also r dot next integer, and a equals to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 divided by b divided by c. So then that is a catching a arithmetic exception. So then system dot out dot println division by 0. Then what is the value of a is displayed. So system dot out dot println a plus a. That's what here we can see what is the values, and how once you change the expression, these values also will change. So the output of the above program is not predictable exactly, as we we are generating random numbers, but the loop will execute 10 times. In each iteration, two random numbers will be generated. When their division results in zero, so then exception will be caught even after the exception loop will continue to be executed. And then displaying a description of an exception, so we can display this description in a println statement by simply passing the exception as an argument. This is possible because throwable overrides the toString method so that it returns a string containing a description of the exception. So here a catch arithmetic exception system dot out dot println exception e, then that will be displayed. So we have seen one catch. So similar fashion we can have a multiple. So not every time we may use only one catch. No, it is not required. So you can use a multiple catches. So in some cases, more than one exception could be raised by a single piece of code. To handle this type of situation, we can specify two or more catch clauses. Each catch a different types of exception. When an exception is thrown, each catch statement is inspected in order, and the first one whose type matches that of the exception is executed. After one catch statement executes, the other are bypassed and execution continues after try and catch block. So in this case, class multi-catch, then public static void main string arguments. So then try catch, so the try and catch A is initialized, B is initialized, and array C. So in A, what we are doing, argument length, as well as we are just printing what is the value we have in the A. So in the same way, B equals to 42 divided by A. So the A value what we have assigned, and C is array of one element. Then Z42, we are saying it as a 99. So then catch, first catch, what it is catching? It is catching the arithmetic exception. And in the second catch, what it is doing? It is doing a array indexed out of bound exception. So then array spray index COB divide by zero. So then after try and catch block, while using multiple catch blocks, we should give the exception types in a hierarchy of subclass to superclass, because catch statement that uses a superclass will catch all exceptions of its own type plus all that of its subclasses. Hence, the subclass exception given after a superclass exception is never caught and is an unreachable code, that is an error in the Java. So then taking the small example program, so here super subclass catch. So in this main program, we have a try and catch. So in the try and catch block, so we have taken in A as integer data type and initialized it to zero. So in the same way, integer B is initialized, then 42 by A. So here in case if we replace A by zero, so then B will become infinite. So that's what here we can see. Catch exception E, system dot out dot println, generic exception catch. So then one more catch, because there may be one more error, and that may be because of arithmetic exception. So then again, we have to display that is never reached. So that's what here this program explains. So the arithmetic exception has already been caught. Catching a arithmetic exception and the error. So nested try statement. So how we know that one within one more. Same way here, one try within one more try, and we call it as a nested try statement. So then try statement can be nested. That is, a try statement can be inside the block of another try. Each time a try statement is entered, the context of that exception is pushed on the stack. If an inner try statement does not have a catch handler for a particular exception, so the stack is unwound and the next try statement is a particular thing. So have a catch handler for a particular exception. So the stack is unwounded and the next try statement catch handler are inspect for a match. This continues until one of the catch statement succeeds, or until all the statement matches, then the java.runtime system will handle the exception. So taking an example here, you can see nested try. So here, take a try. So outside the try, you have a integer a and integer equals to arguments dot length and int equals to b equals to 42 by a. So then display them. If that is fine, okay, or else we have to use one more try catch. So then if a equals to 1 and if a equals to 1, a equals to a divided by a minus a. If a2 equals to 2, int c equals to 1, c of 10 plus 9. So then catch array index out of bound exception e, then system.out.println array index out of bound. So then catch arithmetic exception, then system.out.println divide by 0, then plus e. So method is enclosed within a try block, and the method itself contains a try block. It is considered to be a nested try block. So that's what here you can see. So in this nested try, so we have used first as void nested try, then try t. Here if a equals to 1, a equals to a divided by a minus a. If a equals to 2, then int c equals to 1, then c 42 equals to 99. Java catch array out of bound exception e. So then system dot out dot println. So the array index out of bound, then display the object e. So then we are creating a main, that is system dot out dot println. So try and catch. So in the try, a equals to arguments dot length, int b equals to 42 by a, system dot out dot println memories a. I think only that's there in this program. Okay, next is throw. So till now we have seen calculating, catching the exception that are thrown by a Java runtime system. It is possible for our program to throw an exception explicitly using the throw statement. The general form of throw is shown here for a throwable instance. Here throwable instance must be an object of a type throwable or a subclass or a throwable. Primitive types such as int or a char, as well as known throwable classes. Abstract such a string and an object cannot be used as an exception. So there are two ways we can obtain a throwable object: using a parameter in a catch clause and creating one with a new operator. So here class throw demo, static void demo procedure. So then try and catch. So throw new null pointer exception, then catch null pointer exception e. So then system dot out dot println caught inside the demo pro. So public static void means string arguments demo pro, we are calling a demo pro and displaying them. So here new is used to construct an instance of null pointer exception. Many of the Java built-in runtime exceptions have at least two constructor, one with no parameter and one that takes a single parameter. So when the second form is used, the argument specifies a string that describes the exception. The string is displayed when the object is used as an argument to print or println. It can also be obtained by a class to get a message, which is defined by a throwable. What is throws? If a method is capable of causing an exception that it does not handle, it must specify this behavior so that caller of the method can guarantee themselves against this exceptions. We can do this by including a throws clause in a method's declaration. Throw clause lists the type of exception that a method might throw. This is necessary for all exception except those for type error or runtime exception or any of their subclasses. All other exceptions that a method can throw must be declared in a throws clause. If they are not, a complete time error will be resulted. The general form of a method declaration that includes throws clause. So what is a general syntax? So type, you give any method name, give any number of parameter list. So then throws, we have to use a keyword called as a throws, and a list exception, how many exception list you want, we can give. So then the body of a method, you can declare any body of a particular method. Here, exception list is a common base, common separate.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, what about the innovative and case study questions?
Yeah, that's what I'll be just giving you. Innovative and case study questions will come within this exceptions only. So if you study this third module, so it will be covering your innovative and the case study question. Any doubt about that?
It will be of programs, right, ma'am?
Yeah, maybe one program or something like you can write. So something like exceptions, what is exception? What are the five keywords? So write a program. How do you write a try and catch block? Something like that will be your innovative and case study question.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay, so I'll stop here and I'll take attendance and then close it. Fast, you answer the attendance. Time 24. Anaga, Abhilash,
yes, ma'am.
Akhil,
yes, ma'am.
Akrut,
yes, ma'am.
Anusha, Arvind,
yes, ma'am.
Arvind. Arifulla,
yes, ma'am.
Vinaka,
present, ma'am.
Panu Prakash,
ma'am.
Bhargav,
yes, ma'am.
Rahmatullah,
present, ma'am.
Chaitra,
present, ma'am.
Chandana, Charan. Darshan.
Yes, ma'am.
2S. Who is who?
Diksha.
Yes, ma'am.
Dakshayani.
Present, ma'am.
Kishan.
Present, ma'am.
Harshit. Yamalata.
Present, ma'am.
Uma.
Present, ma'am.
Jayant.
Present, ma'am.
Divya?
Yes, ma'am.
Kaushik?
Present, ma'am.
Lakshmi? लावण्या
माइक इशू
या मात लावण्या
लावण्या प्रेजेंट मैम
मनीषा मनीष
प्रेजेंट मैम
मनोज
प्रेजेंट मैम
मोहित
यस मैम
नवल
यस मैम
नव्या
प्रेजेंट मैम
निखिल
प्रेजेंट मैम
पनींद्र
प्रेजेंट मैम
पवन
यस मैम
पूजा
प्रेजेंट मैम
पूर्णिमा
प्रेजेंट मैम
रमन
प्रेजेंट मैम
रश्मि
प्रेजेंट मैम
रूपक रूपक
यस मैम
साई कुमार
प्रेजेंट मैम
समीर
प्रेजेंट मैम
संतोष
प्रेजेंट मैम
सदाब
प्रेजेंट मैम
शरण
प्रेजेंट मैम
शशांक
प्रेजेंट मैम
शीतल
प्रेजेंट मैम
शिवानी सौम्य सौम्यश्री
प्रेजेंट मैम
स्फूर्ति स्फूर्ति
प्रेजेंट मैम
श्री विष्णु
प्रेजेंट मैम
सुगंधिनी
प्रेजेंट मैम
सुषमा
प्रेजेंट मैम
सुष्मिता डीएस
प्रेजेंट मैम
सुषमा यू
प्रेजेंट मैम
तीर्था
प्रेजेंट मैम
तृप्ति
प्रेजेंट मैम
वर्षा
प्रेजेंट मैम
वीना
प्रेजेंट मैम
सो योर इनोवेटिव एंड सदाब सदाब मैट योर इनोवेटिव एंड केस स्टडी क्वेश्चन विल कम इन द एक्सेप्शन
मैम चंदना प्रेजेंट मैम
या चंदना इल मार्क
मैम आशिक प्रेजेंट मैम
ओके